This is the Wizard, WZRD Chicago, 88.3 FM. We have with us today at Wizard a very special guest who is part of the history of editorial cartooning, African American work, and he is Tim Jackson. Tim, welcome to Wizard.
Thank you.
Well, first of all, Tim, describe your work as an editorial cartoonist and what in your background best prepared you for this work.
What made me best prepared for this work? It's hard to say. It's simply something that came to me. At the time I started doing it years ago, there was very few, if any, African American cartoonists who did editorial cartoons. That was just what I knew at the time because I had not been introduced to some of the big newspapers around the country that were owned by African Americans and mm-hmm. had someone to draw cartoons for them.
I see.
Mm-hmm. For instance, I drew a cartoon and I sent it around to different newspapers.
Mm-hmm. And it was hard to get accepted if they were white owned, is that kind of what you're saying? Did you send to any white newspapers or?
It was like that. Not completely, but
right.
They usually had somebody already.
I see.
Was the situation.
What was your first big break then?
First big break. I was working as a layout person mm-hmm. at the Chicago Defender newspaper here in Chicago.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And the regular person had been there for like 48 years, and mm-hmm. his health wasn't very good. So one of the managers of the newspaper came up to me and said, how'd you like to draw cartoons for us?
Mm-hmm.
I said, so, well, okay.
Of course. So you showed your work to someone at the Defender already, right? And
yes.
then finally they came around and do you remember what it was, what the subject matter was that drew them to say, now we want your work in print?
I don't know exactly which will be the very first.
That's okay, but what about the subject matter? What time, part of American history was it at that time?
It was a cartoon, I believe, that has something to do with Mayor Daley.
Mm-hmm. The first one?
The first one that I...
Yeah, the first Mayor Daley, right? The father?
I don't know, the...
The son?
Son.
Okay.
Maybe not that one.
Right, well... Right. Okay. Yeah, okay. You once answered that you started drawing by imitating your brother. So how does your work differ from your brother's?
Well, at this point in time, very different because he doesn't draw anymore.
Mm-hmm.
But I guess we're still in the same predicament because his editorials do music.
Okay. Oh.
And I do mine through art. So I guess we're still talking about the same subjects, just
right.
different presentations.
Yes. What's your brother's name? Because we at Wizard, we're freeform, and we love to, that's the kind of work that we want to showcase. And
mm-hmm.
What is your brother's name? We'll have to find his albums and then play them here at Wizard.
Okay, his name is Charles Jackson.
Okay, Charles Jackson. Okay. How much is editorial cartooning news, and how much is it editorial, and how much is it art?
It's not enough of all those things.
Mm-hmm.
It's art because it's a drawing.
Right.
It's news because it's usually about something that's happening in the news.
Mm-hmm.
Or a politician or a social situation.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And I don't think the third thing is good.
Editorial. How much is it commentary?
Most of it's commentary.
Exactly.
So it's a little piece of everything that goes into making one thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess when you're actually doing it, you don't really think about it.
Mm-hmm. Right. Okay. How difficult is it for black cartoonists to break into print? Before and let's say now.
Before it was very difficult.
Mm-hmm.
Now it's become part of the culture, so to speak.
Mm-hmm. And do you have any idea how many black cartoonists are working in all the different platforms in like newspapers, etc. Versus, do you have any idea about the percentage? How much work is produced by African Americans?
2%. 2 people.
Oh, okay, that's you, and one other person.
Well, there's current Chinese on the West Coast by the name of Darren Bell.
Mm-hmm.
And a cartoonist by the name of, I mean, brain freeze is a thing that should be able to speak without thinking.
Oh, that's okay. And but you you wrote a book. You compiled a lot of research about black cartoonists from the 1800s to now, right? Pioneering cartoonists. Pioneering cartoonists of color. I saw that you spent a lot of time in researching it, right? Mm-hmm. And you did an interview with the Evanston Public Library.
Yes, that's been a while ago.
Mm-hmm.
But what I tried to do with this book is something that I couldn't find in the libraries.
Mm-hmm.
Information about African American cartoonists and mm-hmm. their art and what they did.
Mm-hmm.
So I literally went around through microfilm after microfilm and mm-hmm. everything I could look at and find this information.
Mm-hmm.
And I put it together in the form of a book
mm-hmm.
that gives the history of what was happening at the time, all the way up to the fact, the part where it's become common.
Mm-hmm.
The 1960s was a turning point.
Mm-hmm. Was it politics? What made it the turning point? Because of the Voting Rights Act and et cetera? And did that help?
That helped.
Mm-hmm.
So what it was, like in 1968, it was a big call on. We wanted to have black cartoonists and black cartoons in the newspaper.
Mm-hmm.
Before the 60s, didn't nobody care.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what made the biggest difference is it had become part of culture now.
Mm-hmm. How are there more African American artists than cartoonists? There's only two right now? Are African American cartoonists?
Two that are currently published as an editorial cartoon.
Mm-hmm. Right. Just so you were talking more about editorial cartoons. What about in your book? Was that are those all editorial cartoons or cartoonists? How did you what kind of work were you able to compile?
Editorial cartoonists mm-hmm. and comic strip artists. Mm-hmm.
I see. And then what about the comic books scene now with the African American cartoonists? Are there more opportunities for that? Because I do have some friends at school that that are drawing and they hope to begin to print as well.
Mm-hmm. Well, these days, unlike when I was doing it, it's a lot easier because we've got the internet.
Right.
So a lot of people are running full stories on the internet of cartoons that they've created.
Mm-hmm.
And they've got an audience because the internet is just so huge. You always have somebody that likes what you're doing
mm-hmm.
as opposed to when I was doing it in the 80s and 90s.
Mm-hmm.
It was a matter of the editor liking it.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So it's better now, because you can get your work out there, or hopefully some editor will see it, because you have an audience even though you don't have this place.
Mm-hmm. What about you? What kind of editorial cartooning are you drawing? Are you doing now?
Well, right now I'm not doing much of anything, since the book came out, editorial pioneering cartoonist and color, since the book has been out, my energy has been on the book.
Are you still, is it still in print? Could our listeners access it, the book? Is it on Amazon?
It's on Amazon.
Okay.
And it's at the University Press of Mississippi. Also, we're there who published it.
It's Pioneering Cartoonists of Color by Tim Jackson. So where is the cover from?
Cover is my creation.
Beautiful.
So I want to try to encapsulate the whole meaning. The drawing and the writing. Trying to put all it together with clips of the various cartoonists of the day. I would like to have more in there, but they stop me.
Oh, that's perfect. That's very beautiful. How popular then are the online platforms for the audience to find new work from Black cartoonists? How popular are the online platforms for the audience to find new work from a Black cartoonist? Where could they go online to find more work? From Black cartoonists or Black editorial cartoonists? I think that is more of the focus with our students over here.
It depends on what the cartoon is about. It can make the whole difference. Now, for instance, I did a cartoon series called What Are Friends For? This is younger days, and had a younger audience too. And I had to go out and try to talk to the editors and publishers and show them my work. It was tedious.
Of course.
So what I did is I saved up enough money and I had a certain amount of books printed. And with the books in hand, I would go show it to people and
basically self-published.
Yes. So that's what's happening now that was hardly happening back then when I was doing it. But now self-publishing and computer-aided publishing just something I always wished there was when I was growing up. Just you could draw whatever you want. You can do the layout, you do the printing, you do the marketing.
All online.
All online.
How many books have you published, self-published then?
About 15 different things on different topics.
How has the work of Black editorial cartoonists changed? Just does it change with the as the politics change, the national scene change, or is there more of an underlying current of that separates one group of work from the next group of work? Right. So right now, it's let's say, what is the hot topic now of editorial cartoonists?
Well, I say the topic at hand is the president. So everyone is focused on right now. Since I'm not full-time drawing editorial cartoons, I don't have anything much, and I'll put out something every now and then. It's just so huge that you can't ignore it kind of a situation. But it's the same from then and now. You have to have an audience that wants to see it. So I know a lot of people had to think of what's important to them, selling their story or being told what to do. But I think the biggest change that happened to editorial cartoons, the way I understood it, is with the internet, or the fact that the newspapers are not there. That's the biggest part is the newspaper, monthly, weekly, dailies, have all sort of vanished away over the time.
What are the big names now in editorial cartoonists? Just those two that you mentioned, one on the West Coast. Let me write down the name so we could look them up.
Darren Bell.
Darren Bell. E-A-R-R-E-N. Bell?
E-R-R-I-N.
I-N, okay. And the second one is, because I think our listeners are very interested to examine the work, to see what it's like.
David Brown.
David Brown. Okay.
He's in LA.
LA.
He draws for, what's the newspaper? LA Sentinel.
And Darren Bell?
I'm not sure where he is now.
Oh, that's okay.
He's still working full time. He does. Canterville. And he does an editorial cartoon as well.
Mm-hmm. Out of all, yeah, go ahead.
I was gonna say, there are others that I'm having memory lapse at the moment.
That's okay. That's okay. Because if these are the two that stand out, we could go from there. What about your own work? What part of your work in your work are you most proud of? Besides your book.
I guess it's not this book, it's some other book. I enjoy being in a position where people saw what I did and could make comments on it.
Mm-hmm.
So every 5 years or so, I try to put together a book from my cartoons.
Mm-hmm. So I see that you brought some other work over there. Is that some other drawings that you have?
Some earlier things. Mm-hmm. This is the earliest of them all. I was 22 years old.
Mm-hmm.
I published a book about sign language.
Friends are for signing.
So I did an illustrated sign language in a cartoon.
So this
I'd say probably the thing that all the listeners should think of when they're trying to get their work out there is, what do they have that's really important to say?
Mm-hmm.
It's best to make your cartoon about something you understand.
Mm-hmm. Of course.
So if you try to write about something that you're not familiar with, it's not going to come out very clear to the readers.
Mm-hmm. Did you study sign language before you drew this book?
Yes, I took a year of sign language back in high school.
So are you still fluent in the sign language?
No.
That's okay.
Well, I can still do it when I have to, just I have to think about it more than I used to.
Mm-hmm. So, very beautiful. And that was your first work that you published?
It's the first work that was published by someone else of my work.
Right.
So all the others are self-published.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, the newest one is put out by the University Press of Mississippi.
Mm-hmm. And which publisher published that, the Friends Are For Signing?
I think me.
Mm-hmm.
It was printed and put together by the National Association of the Deaf.
Oh, okay.
This was back in 82.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful.
And since they didn't try to take away the copyright, it's still mine.
Mm-hmm. Right. That's good. And can people find this online? Because I think that there will be listeners that do want to check it out. It's a very beautiful book.
I'm not sure if there's still any online. Mm-hmm. I see it every now and then, but going further into it, it's like they don't have it.
Mm-hmm.
They don't have it listed as they do.
Mm-hmm. At Wizard, all on-air DJs or wizards have to file quarterly issues or non-entertainment programming with the FCC, the Federal Communications Commission. So Wizard wants to derive those quarterly issue topics from the community. So first of all, what do you, as a voice for our community, care most about? Yes, the one thing that you care most about.
Is various health issues.
Mm-hmm. Do you want to elaborate it a little bit, just a little bit?
No. Yes. As I get older, the more I'm concerned about the issues.
Mm-hmm.
So I do what I can to stay healthy and eat the right things and do mm-hmm. the right things, and I feel that it's something that everyone should do.
Right. If, for instance, if young people take care of themselves better when they are young, they have fewer problems when they're older.
Yes.
What is the most important long-term issue that needs to be resolved?
The biggest issue, I guess, keeping this world healthy.
Mm-hmm. It's hard.
It's hard.
What about
cartoons about it? So they should all draw cartoons about it.
Yes. Well, you should too.
I have over the years. Now it's their turn.
Okay. Oh, you have. So there is one. Do you remember some of the titles that maybe our listeners could look up? I think that they'll be very interested in looking that up. I will too.
No, I don't have anything like that with me.
Oh, that's okay. That's okay. Well, we can still find it. Don't worry about it.
Okay.
Let's turn our trash into money. Recycle and profit. Okay. What year was this put out? Let's see. This must have been way before the, a little bit before the current craze into recycling.
Yes, it was.
Beautiful. I see that it was published by the Chicago Housing Authority for its residents. So did the residents get a copy, or was it the children that got a copy as an activities book?
Well, it was aimed at the children.
Mm-hmm.
I think parents got into it too.
Mm-hmm.
It says here in 1991.
Mm-hmm. Very good.
What?
Let's turn our trash into money. What?
It used to be with the Chicago Housing Authority.
Mm-hmm.
They ran a program called
Economic Development Department.
Mm-hmm. They mm-hmm. ran a program to encourage residents to recycle.
Yes.
They were bringing their cans and bottles and get them weighed, and they get weighed for a certificate for picking up some cash.
Oh.
So it's encouraged to recycle as a way to make more money.
Mm-hmm. How successful was the program?
Yeah, it went successfully when it started.
Mm-hmm.
I think it made it past year five.
Oh.
But I'm not sure if there's anyone who I work with on it is not there anymore.
Mm-hmm. So it sounds like a very reasonable program. Yeah. I guess when the it went citywide. So was this already, was it during the, it must have been, if it was in 91, I think that was before the, way before the citywide recycling program.
Mm-hmm.
Almost 10 years before.
Wow. That's something I could encourage young people to do,
mm-hmm.
is to create comics on issues like that.
Mm-hmm.
times. I went through a lot of different programs and issues to get some of the stuff. Like, I worked with the Department of Health to do cartoons that encourage safe sex and issues like that.
And were you able to, was the material that you produce distributed widely into the community? Do you have any idea about its distribution?
It was available at the Department of Health.
Mm-hmm.
You know, people came in to do whatever else they wanted to do. The books are displayed so they could know they were there and get one.
Mm-hmm. I see that you know, you've been drawing all your life. You got the inspiration from your brother. Did you have any training at any time, at any point, or is all this beautiful work just from practice?
From practice.
No training at all, no classes?
Well, at this time, no. That's mm-hmm. how I got to Chicago, is I went to the Art Institute.
Mm-hmm.
And after I moved here to attend the Art Institute, I decided to stay.
Mm-hmm. You mean you did take classes there, or you just like you took classes? Okay. Were you able to get a scholarship there? Because your art is so wonderful. I think they give scholarships?
No, because I never got one.
Oh. So, go ahead.
No, it's just, I would encourage young people to find an issue that they believe in and draw about it.
Mm-hmm.
So that's pretty much what I have done in everything that you see here, is I found something that was needed.
Mm-hmm.
For instance, sign language.
Mm-hmm. Did you approach them, or did you draw? Did you approach them with the idea, and then they and then show them examples of your work, the Sign Language Institute, and then you work with them on the project. The same with the CHA. How did these projects originate?
Well, with the recycling program, it was a friend who worked for the Department of
Economic Development.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And he asked me if I would be interested in creating a book for him.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty much left up to me to do it, but when he got me to do it,
mm-hmm.
and he showed me like little scribbles and sketches and printouts of things that they wanted to be said on the page.
Mm-hmm. Like the storyboard, right? They show you like kind of a storyboard, and then you go from there.
Mm-hmm. So I used a character that was part of my comic. That was selfish on my part because I wanted my characters to be seen, so they made it to the cover of the book and throughout the book, because it's a coloring book for young kids.
Mm-hmm. Okay, who are the characters?
Well, the character in the hat, he is called Guan.
Mm-hmm.
Next to him is his mother. So that's that parallel participation.
Mm-hmm.
And throughout the most of the book, it's one his little sister, who I don't even think was given a name yet, and she appeared in this. But she helped bring out the ideas of the child, the questions a child might ask.
Mm-hmm.
So that's how the book was put together. So it's taking a brochure and ask the questions.
Mm-hmm.
So I made it the same way.
Mm-hmm. Very beautiful. What about your book with the Sign Language Institute? How did that one come about?
That's part of my cartoons development. Because I knew one of these cartoons, the One of France Four cartoons, were meant to be a comic strip series.
Mm-hmm.
After I did all the drawings, couldn't sell the idea and the story about sign language, or somebody learning sign language.
Mm-hmm.
So I finally got to Chicago, started staying here. I put together cartoons and you're learning maps again.
Oh, is that right?
So, what was the question again?
Just how did the project come about? That's a self-published book, but it was with the Sign Language Institute, right? They helped spread the word too. Did they come to you and ask your help with the project, or did you submit the work to them as part of something that they could use?
Friend of mine sent it to me.
Ah, did you get money from it?
Yes.
And he sent it to them.
Yeah, he's going to. When you answered the question from before in the last debate.
Oh, that's okay. Oh, just how so it's your friend that linked you to the project, because this is how our students would like to learn. If they take your advice and do something that they about an issue that they really care about, what's the best way to get their work out there? You know, besides online, but what steps in networking, etc. So that's why I was asking you about how you got your work to these various organizations like the CHA and the Sign Language Institute.
I was working on comic strips to make a series that I was going to take to the newspapers and sell as a do that. After getting turned down from everything, I had to choose another way. And I was working at another agency, youth agency, where they had an in-house publishing company. So I sold them on the idea that they could print the books for me, and I would make care of selling them. So the cartoons were all together. I'm trying to say before I lose it again that I turned the comic strips into comic books. So what I did is I took the strips and I taped them up together to make a page. So I switched from comic strips to comic books. Because I couldn't get anyone interested, so I found a whole new way and put it together as a comic book. And I would sell it on whatever story is. Like, for instance, That's All You're Good For, a story about sexual drawn feelings.
Which is what you're saying is the topic is love versus sex, I think.
Yes.
So that comic book, were you able to sell it? It's very beautifully put together.
Thank you. Well, this is one that went to the Department of Health. Chicago Department of Health want these. And what I also did is I sold them on the back page of the book. You could put anything you want on there for a certain amount. So I put the books together to have that kind of use.
Like advertising on the back. This was distributed. That's All They're Good For? That book was distributed at the Chicago Department of Health.
Yes. This one is done by the Office of AIDS Prevention, called Friends and Choices, which talk about choices to make and what you would do for friends or what you wouldn't do for friends. And of course, you saw that all the characters in the books and the pages of the cartoons were the same group of characters.
Do you want to talk a little bit about your characters? Why do these characters, who they are, the main ones, and why they stuck with you?
Well, I wanted to have a revolving cast of characters, and I also have to make it make sense to other people, because I lived with these characters for so long. I knew everything about them. I had to make sure that when I reproduced a book, they would be the same way. So, for instance, the topic is drug and alcohol use.
Friends and choices.
So the story goes along with what they finally reach their situation.
How long did it take you to draw all of this? Some, I guess some works that take longer, some works don't take as long. So, but how about this one, for example? Do you still remember how long it took you to draw?
I don't remember how long it took. I know it was one of the longest ones because the research that went into it. So like I said, try to make it.
Friends and choices. Yeah, this is the back page for the ads. And let's see the ad. I see that you have a couple of questions over here. What do you think about it? So these are almost like discussion questions for classrooms.
It's meant to encourage education. There's another color book called HIV Safe.
HIV Safe. By learning how HIV is not spread is the best way to stay safe from AIDS.
So what I tried to do with this book is work with the younger kids. And I want to make the issue of what you don't do to keep you safe. It's not all the material I looked at and saying this is what's going to get you type of thing. And I wanted to make it HIV safe, where you learn how not to get into the situation as opposed to telling what the situations are.
Was it hard for you to define the line about how to express all of this in a comic?
Well, yeah.
I would assume so.
Sorry.
But you were able to do it.
Like I said, it's to me the characters all have personalities that I understand, which makes everything that happens to them part of what I'm working with. And also, if you have a little fun with it. So everything's not completely serious all the time.
Right. I see that the first page illustrated some person sitting on a defective chair. And then I guess what you're saying is that if you know how to warn someone, then you should do it.
Is required.
It's required.
Well, the next one is a name.
She is immune to harm and danger.
And there's deep deficient.
I see.
And that's for syndrome. Cartoon character for represent HIV.
Right. That's clever. I have representation, drawing for every letter for acquired immune deficiency syndrome, and then finally putting it that all together. Very good.
So introducing this little character to the comic, The rest of it goes on from there, but whenever he's there, there's a possibility.
Mm-hmm.
It's not there, you know, it's safe.
Mm-hmm.
For instance, behind the no sign, because you know it's safe from being affected that way.
Mm-hmm. Well, I guess right now, someone needs to come up with something as beautiful to warn people against how to keep safe from the coronavirus.
Yeah, I was thinking that I was out in the snow walking.
Mm-hmm. Well, do you have any ideas?
Do I have any ideas?
Yes. Maybe you could, maybe you'll be the one to draw it.
Oh, possible.
There was a third question for our quarterly issues. What is the most important issue to be resolved now?
Still communication.
So better did you say better communication?
Yes, still is the situation right now.
Mm-hmm.
It's better communication.
Mm-hmm. And I see better communications in what areas that matter the most? Just among people? Every day.
I think the same approach. Talk about what's not the danger.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And to talk about lots and lots of danger, people get enough of that, they don't worry about it anymore.
Do you find that what made you successful as a cartoonist was that you realized what you are trying to achieve is better communication.
Mm-hmm.
What advice do you have for aspiring editorial cartoonist, Mr. Tim Jackson?
Mm-hmm. Well, my advice would be to find an issue that means something to you personally.
Mm-hmm.
And work it from there. So I think a lot of the best editorial cartooning comes from cartoonists who are really passionate about what they're doing.
Mm-hmm.
And not just filling the blank of who's the next person you're making fun of.
Mm-hmm. Well, Tim Jackson, editorial cartoonist, Black editorial cartoonist, thank you so much for being with us on Wizard, and we appreciate your work, and much luck to you on your next book.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you.
It's a pleasure to be here.
Thank you so much. Oh. Yeah, don't have it. Let me turn the camera off. Oops, sorry. You're more interested in drawing versus talking.